In this video, I'm going to explain the setup for the course and what you need to install and how to install that. Mostly, first of all, Python and then all the other libraries and stuff to get everything to run. Note that installing Python on your local system works relatively easy for, will work relatively easy for most of you. However, there are always some problems where it just takes ages and even we can't really help and we need ages too. Because it's even harder to help with these problems if you're not sitting at the same screen next to trying to help you privately in Skype. We also provide this year an environment which you can simply use in your web browser where you don't need to install anything at all. I'm going to go into detail about that. So first of all, we code in Python. And Python is a programming language, and every programming language is normally programmed in some IDE, an integrated development environment. Which IDE are we going to use? So there are as many IDEs as there are opinions about them. For example, PyCharm, Visual Studio Code, Atom, Notepad++, Vi, Emacs, and so on and so on. We in this course will use JupyterLab. JupyterLab is something on top of Python and the interactive kernel IPython, which can not only create first of all, it's great for interactive development, and it's normally what's used in scientific context. But it's also really useful because you can not only create pure scripts, but you can also make pretty stuff, including headlines and your results and your code in one single file. For example, your plots, so that you can convert that to a PDF and then send that to somebody and you can view it with the results without that person having to install Python. It just looks so much prettier. And please save yourself the pain and don't code in Windows Notepad without any kind of like syntax highlighting, code completion. These are incredibly useful tools. And if you're programming more, then you're going to notice how much faster your workflow becomes if you're using good IDE. Said we will mostly use JupyterLab, but I will still explain which IDEs there are. So one really nice IDE which we used in the first iteration of this class is Atom. You can get Atom at this link, or simply if you're using Linux, you can simply apt-get install it. And Atom is really cool if you use it together with the package Hydrogen. I'm going to show that here. I'm just going to run Atom here. And I'm just going to create a new file, and I'm just going to put some Python code in here. I'm going to save that somewhere. Code.py. And now I have Python code here. And what's really cool about Atom is that when I select the code I want to run, if I have Hydrogen installed, and then I press Control and Enter, because Hydrogen connects me to a Python kernel, I can run stuff in an interactive kernel. And now, for example, I ran the code a equals 1 plus 1, and now if I Control Enter what is a, it will tell me 1, 2, it will tell me 2, 1 plus 1. Atom also nicely renders, for example, NumPy lists and pandas data frames, and it just looks really nice, and the interactive kernel is really fun to code with. So if I run more code, for example, it shows me nicely rendered and the like. So Atom is a nice editor if you don't want to use JupyterLab. However, we still prefer JupyterLab. Atom is free and open source, and besides Jupyter, I would recommend it for smaller projects containing only a few files. So if you're working on a huge project with multiple people in like some big setting, and you have multiple different kinds of scripts and stuff, more files, then Atom becomes really hard, because Atom is not actually an IDE, but just a better notepad. Together with Hydrogen, it's really nice to run Python, but it's still not an IDE. So I would recommend Atom for smaller projects and PyCharm for larger projects. PyCharm is commercial and closed source. However, it does have a community edition, which is free, and even the professional edition is free as a student. It has many components, for example, an interactive visual debugger, code analysis features, Git integration, and like a bunch of other stuff you can simply download and which is integrated in. I use PyCharm for all my projects, and I'm convinced that like once you master PyCharm, it's just making you code so much faster. However, like I said, it's useful if you have bigger projects containing more files, and if you simply work on one script or one file, as for example in the homework of this class, PyCharm is pretty much an overkill. We will, however, as Philip told you in a previous video, eventually switch to PyCharm to show the debugging features. Then there's VI, which is integrated into many Unix systems. So for example, here it's always there. If I run a terminal here and I run VI, then I can add stuff here and colon Q exclamation. So VI it runs inside the terminal, as for example also Nano does. Nano is a bit more intuitive, we can use control and stuff. Close. However, it's supposedly much faster once you mastered it, because you just don't move your hands away from the keyboard ever. You don't use the mouse, it's nothing visual, nothing with the mouse, it's just hardcore terminal commands. It's supposed to be much faster once you mastered it. I still haven't mastered it. I use Nano sometimes. I use VI hardly ever, never. So supposedly much faster, but nothing for us. Now JupyterLab. JupyterLab is what we want to use, because JupyterLab is nice, because it cannot only work with pure code files, but also notebook files that contain code, formatted text, and results of running your code. These notebooks are then nicely rendered on GitHub and can be exported to HTML or PDF, or simply to a Python script. And JupyterLab can also edit standard Python files and use them with an interactive kernel. Okay, now that I talked about these, I'm going to show the interactive kernel in a second, but first I want to show you what's the easiest way of working in this class, working without installing anything. We have a link for you, and that's hub.cyprog.org, hub.cyprog.de, I'm sorry. So just like I didn't try this domain earlier, this domain here is dashboards.cyprog.de. And at hub.cyprog, there's a Jupyter hub. So how does Jupyter work, first of all? Jupyter notebooks are in your web browser. If you start a Jupyter kernel, you're going to run on some PC. If you want Jupyter Lab locally on your laptop, you're just going to run it on your own PC. You start a server, and then you open a web browser and connect to a certain port, so namely to your server, which then communicates. So the actual kernel will be in your server, and what you see, so the front end basically, is then your web browser. And when using Jupyter Hub, like we're doing here, the kernel you're running, the Jupyter kernel, is not on your own machine, but on some Kubernetes cluster, so on some Kubito cluster somewhere owned by Google. That means for you, you only need your web browser. So nothing to install, just opening this link, logging in via GitHub, as you saw me doing it, and ta-da, now you have it open. That's really nice and the easiest way to work with. However, note that we're paying for these servers, and the more people are using it simultaneously, the more computers are going to run these servers at the same time, and the more we pay. So if you can install Python on your local machine, please do so, because it's cheaper for us. Okay, so this here is the link then, and now I can run. For example, I can open either an IPython notebook file or simply a text file. I can rename that to my Python file .py. Python always has the ending .py. And then I can print 1+1. And then I can save it. And then I can also, on this plus, open a terminal. I can even move the terminal here, because Jupyter, in contrast to Jupyter Notebook, which is like a bit older than Jupyter Lab, on Jupyter Lab you can have open, you can have multiple things open at the same time. For example, I can have open the text editor of Jupyter Lab and a terminal of Jupyter Lab. And now I can simply run my Python file here. Python, my Python file, and it will print to the result of 1+1, which I entered here. Okay, so like I said, the hub is a nice way to work on the task without having to install Python. However, close the session and use it only if needed, because the more users online, the more we pay. And if too many are online, so we have a maximum number of machines that we provide for that, because otherwise it gets too expensive for us. So it can become slow if there are too many people online at the same time. And it may also be a bit buggy at first, because it's the first time we've configured such a thing. So please bear with us. And by a bit buggy, I mean that nobody besides me could log in so far, but we're working on that. Okay. Next up, I'm going to show you how to work with installing everything.